tell you a story about my childhood rivers. I grew up in California. We live near the American River in the foothills east of Sacramento. My dad taught me how to pan for gold right there. In middle school, we lived near the Delta where the Sacramento and San Joaquin rivers joined together in the Central Valley. One summer, we went canoeing up on the Rogue River in Oregon. We attempted to go fishing quite unsuccessfully in the Deschutes River in Bend, Oregon. And I'm pretty sure that this was my first boat ride on my grandfather's boat on the Columbia River in Washington State. Thankfully, boat safety has come a long way since then. I grew up with rivers. And they were a big part of how I experienced nature as a kid. But life was going to take me in different directions. I went off to study geology in the desert, about as far from rivers as you can get. I could not have predicted how one river in particular was going to wind itself back into my life. Let me tell you a story about moving to Tucson to attend the University of Arizona. I was clueless about the Colorado River. I knew it existed, but I knew nothing about water rights, the enormous agricultural output that relies on it, or the environmental degradation caused by dams. I just thought it was that river that carved the Grand Canyon. And somehow my disinterest remained intact throughout college. I was out in the desert, immersed in the geology of the Southwest, a lot of which has been exposed by that river. I was vaguely aware that Tucson got some of its water from the Colorado, but it was far away. And honestly, I was busy with school and research projects and just trying to get into grad school. I just didn't pay attention to that river. A lot of us have not been paying attention to that river. Have you ever eaten lettuce in the wintertime? Yeah, we probably all have, right? Yes. Well, you have eaten the Colorado River. Most of the winter leafy greens are grown in Southern California and Arizona. We have turned that little ribbon of water in the desert into a complex plumbing system that now we cannot live without. Let me tell you a story about these dams. They represent our attempt to control the river, to bend it to our will, to take water and collect it where it otherwise would not be. Seems we've succeeded for a little bit. Lake Mead and Lake Powell and all the other dams on the river provide water for 40 million people. And 80% of the water in that river is used for agriculture. There's just one little problem. There is not enough water in the river. There never has been. When the river was originally divided up in 1922, they based it off of abnormally high flows. There's never been that much water in the river ever since. We've been working from a deficit since the start. And now we're living with the cost of that mistake. Here in Las Vegas, we are well acquainted with at least one of these dams, the one on the right. We've all seen the pictures of sunken boats emerging out of Lake Mead. I took that picture of Hoover Dam in 2015. There's a lot more of that bathtub ring showing these days. Lake Mead and Lake Powell are at their historic low levels. Let me tell you a story about going to grad school in Los Angeles. I finally started learning about all this. I mean, I'd grown up in the 80s in California during those big droughts. I had heard about water conservation, but it sure seemed like that wasn't much of a concern in daily LA life. So when the opportunity arose for me to create a new class for undergrads, I decided to build it around the Colorado River. We talked about water use issues and what the future might hold, especially with climate change bearing down on us. It's also a good excuse to take a field trip to the Grand Canyon. I took the students to the North and South Rims, and we visited Glen Canyon Dam. And we looked at that little green stream of water down below. And that was it. Even though I now had a better understanding of the issues surrounding the Colorado River, I still didn't feel much of a connection to it. Interesting things to know, but whatever. I went off to a university faculty position where I created field camps that brought students out into the world-class geology of the Southwest. I kept going to the Grand Canyon again and again. But all we did was sit on the rim and vaguely acknowledge that little trickle of water way down there. I could tell something felt off. I was missing something. But what? Every field trip since I was an undergrad, through grad school, as a professor, I was out in the field in these beautiful, stunning landscapes, doing what I was supposed to do. Talking about the science, the geology. But never the place itself. I was missing something. Something big. I wasn't present. I didn't know how to be present. I did not know how to be in that place. Until I started walking in it. Backpacking. Guiding backpacking trips. It was only when I started walking in the Grand Canyon down to that river, I finally started to learn how to slow down, how to stop talking, which is not easy for me, how to start listening. And if you listen long enough and hard enough, nature has some lessons for us. Nature is always ready to serve up a dish of humility when we most need it. And to remind us that we are not above nature, but of nature. Somehow deep down, we know that we came from there. Time spent in nature gives us the chance to reflect on what it really means to be human. I've never known what to do with the word spiritual, but I do know and cannot deny that when I am immersed in nature, there's just this deep, universal understanding that comes up from within. For me, nature is the Colorado River and the Grand Canyon. And the more that I learned from the Colorado River, the more time that I spent with it and next to it and in it and on it, the more passionate I became about sharing its story. The more determined I became to educate everyone I meet about the threats that are facing it. The more resolute I became about doing whatever I can to protect it. When I'm guiding in the canyon, whether we're walking or floating on a boat, that river is my common thread around which I tell the story of the Grand Canyon. When I'm hiking around Lake Mead or paddling below Hoover, that river is what connects me to all of you, to Las Vegas, to the desert. It's our common thread too. In a book about the Colorado River by Kevin Fidarko, he writes, quote, "Deep time and geology provide shattering reminders of the irrelevancy and insignificance of human affairs," end quote. On the scale of extremely long, large geologic time, the river is going to be fine. On the scale of us humans, the river is not okay. We are not okay. Look at this event, why we're all here right now. Here in Las Vegas, we literally rely on that river, and we're all connected to it and by it. But in our busy, noisy, modern lives, we've been pulled away from that connection. How do we get it back? I have shared a lot of stories with you this morning, and I know you all have stories of your own. I'm sure that each of you has your own place in nature that means something to you, where you go to feel that connection with your environment. It could be your backyard. It could be your local city park. It could be Spring Mountain Ranch, Lake Mead, Mount Charleston, Red Rock. It might even be that river. Think about your connection. And you don't have to be outdoorsy. Think about the plants in your garden, the birds in the tree outside your window. Think about what you see when you're walking the dog. Think about your stories. What are they about? Good times with family and friends? Peace? Calm? Quiet? It's a good feeling, right? Even just thinking about being in nature feels good. However, not everyone has stories like yours and mine. Not everyone has access to nature. The outdoors is off limits to so many for physical, social, and economic reasons. We all have people in our lives who cannot experience nature the way we do. How can we bring it to them? Tell your stories. Let's face it, technology makes it easier than ever to share, but a lot harder to listen. It's one thing to impersonally look at social media, you know, scrolling through pretty pictures posted by strangers and maybe not even read the captions. But it's another thing to hear a story from someone they know. Tell your stories. Who can you think of right now that you could share your story with? Your child's classmates, your neighbors up the street, your coworkers, your elected officials, maybe that friend or relative that you've been meaning to call, but you've been totally putting it off. Well, now you have a reason to call. You have a story to share. When we have a story about a place, it's because we're connected to that place. And when we're connected to a place, we care about that place. And when we care about a place, we will protect that place. Tell your stories. Let them flow like a river. What is your next story going to be?